Greetings. I'm Chuck at Home. And today I have with me a very special guest, Mr. Adam Stokes, who has been a longtime Charm developer. Recently, he has begun working in the emergent patterns of Charming with Layers and the Reactive Framework. Go ahead and introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about how you arrived at working with these new technologies.
All right. I'm Adam Stokes. I work for Canonical. We had a sprint a few weeks ago where I met up with you, Chuck, and a few of the other ecosystem guys. And, you know, there was a few lightning talks talking about this new reactive pattern and saying it was the new hotness, and it's been blessed by Canonical as the way to write charms. And it sounded very interesting. And so I've written previous charms in the, I guess you could say, old method, where it's shell scripts. You have a common shell library that you include and you respond to hook changes during application deployments. And it was okay for simple charms, but once you start getting into the bigger ones like MySQL, Postgres, you needed a little bit more. And so the next logical step was to look at what everybody else was doing. And at the time, people were using Charm Helpers, which is a huge library, and it seems like it gets a lot of stuff added on constantly to kind of cater to some of the problems.
Did you say it was kind of a utility drawer of charming tools?
Yeah. So it started off nice, you know, where it was compact. It had focus. And then things like Ansible support and stuff started getting added, and that was okay. And then, you know, as time progressed, it just came like a dumping ground almost, it seems to me, for charm development. And once I felt like it got to that point, I kind of shied away from doing charm work. And if I did any, it would be, you know, basic shell scripts and things like that. Anything where I didn't have to touch pulling in the charmlib library to my charm and just having to maintain a separate copy of that. And so there was a lot of duplication going on. So at that point, I was kind of a little bit, you know, to be honest, frustrated with charm development. It wasn't fun. It got to be cumbersome, it didn't really flow with the way my brain works, I guess you could say. So I do things differently or I have my own way, and it just wasn't flowing with that. So, with that said, you know, we had this conference in Seattle a couple weeks back. I met with the ecosystem guys and saw their lightning talks and like what I saw. So I just thought, you know, I'll give it another chance, check it out, and do this reactive type, charm composition that they were advertising. So I got started with it. It was very simple to get started with. I didn't have to recreate any charms. I could, the cool thing was, is I could reuse like the MySQL and Postgres charms. Didn't have to rewrite any of that stuff. It was very simple to get going, very quick to get up. And it just made sense the way that I developed. So you react to an event, and when that event is emitted, you do something, and that's very simple, and it's very easy to follow and grok and make a charm the way you want, how you think it should be. And when you go back to it, you know, a few days later, you can still look at it and understand what you're doing and what the charm is supposed to do. And maintaining that charm has just been a whole lot easier at that point.
Great. That sounds like a win when it involves easier maintainability. I understand that you've laid some groundwork for Node.js developers by contributing a runtime layer.
Yeah, so the Node.js layer. So when I started looking at doing some development, I liked the idea of layers. So I took that idea and I said, okay, well, I just want to piece together some things, see how it works, see what it does. And so I started with my base, right? So I have a Node.js layer. And what this layer does is all it does is you give it a release. There's a default one set for you. So you give it a Node.js version that you want installed. It uses a node source Debian repo. So, you know, there's a fixed number of releases that are supported. And so I just said, okay, I want to be able to install Node.10 or .12 or 4 or 5. And I want that to be available to me when I start adding on additional layers that's going to make use of that Node.js layer. So that's what that does. So you consume this Node.js layer, and then your application layer on top of that has access to Node and can do the things that you normally do when you develop Node or deploy Node applications.
Awesome. So I also see that we have a layer ghost over here to the left. What's that?
Yeah, so Layer Ghost is it's Ghost blogging software. It's a Node application, and it makes use of obviously my Node.js layer. It makes use of some other layers as well, and an interface which I can go into. But basically, this is your application, right? Like, don't think of, if you don't think of anything else, just think of this is the main beat of the charm that you're going to be dealing with. And that's what's cool about the reactive pattern is you don't really have to care about the rest of the layers. You just have to know that they're kind of there. And so basically the way I have this set up is I have my layer, right? So my layer says I'm going to pull from my Node.js layer. I'm going to consume that. I'm going to consume my Nginx layer. And then I have an interface, right? Because Ghost supports MySQL as an option. So I'm going to go ahead and set up that conversation with MySQL, you know, later. And so the other stuff looks pretty familiar. There's a config.yaml and metadata.yaml. This is still from the charm development perspective where you have your config options and metadata and things like that. So that's not as interesting as the rest of it though. So with that said, I have my reactive library. You can see it's one file, very simple. I didn't pull in any charm helpers or anything like that. I just concentrate on deploying Ghost and how I want to do it. What's cool about the reactive pattern is everything is consumed, right? So you're going to automatically have access to charm helpers. You're going to have access to my Node.js layer. And then, of course, this is a local library that I'll get into. So basically, you know, you have your charms decorators where you have your hooks and your when and your is states. And so I'm going to maximize this. And so you can see, I mean, it's 115 lines plus or minus some empty space. And so it's very simple. It's got a few hooks in it. Actually, it's just got one. And then it has some reactors, I guess you could say. So this is your basic config change hook. Nothing changes from that. But the interesting part here is you can see that there's this is state method that I use, and it basically is telling me that when Nginx is available or when it's not available and when Node.js is not available, I'm just going to do nothing.
So you've established a dependency between these other two layers in your top layer. So it's like, you guys go do your thing, and then when it's my turn and you say that you're available, I'll continue.
Exactly. Like, maybe let me open up the Node.js layer and just kind of, the way you can kind of get an idea of, okay, so you can see this is kind of like my base layer for Node.js. I just inherit from a basic layer that's part of Charms Reactive.
And that removes all the boilerplate that you saw before when you ran charm create.
Yeah, exactly. Like, just including this layer, I don't have to care about charm helpers or any of the Python dependencies. I don't care about any of that stuff. I just know that I'm going to consume this basic layer, and it's going to give me what I need to make use of Node, to make use of the Ghost charm, and so on and so forth. And so you can see this is very simple, right? Like, this is all I need to do for Node.js. I have a hook that says when my application is deployed, this hook is going to fire. It's going to install Node, and that's all it does. And so when you develop your application, in this example, Ghost, Node is already installed, it's already available to you, and you can just make use of it you know, as if it was with you the whole time. And I provide a few helpers, for example, like getting the distribution directory and, you know, a little wrap around NPM so you can do, you know, NPM install and run tests and things like that. So in the overall picture, this is two files. One's the reactive and one's the little helper library. It's 73 lines. And when it installs, you're going to see it's going to set a state and it's going to say Node.js is available. And so I take this state, I'm going to know that Node.js is available. I document it right in the README saying, well, this is installed, but I just say, you know, this is all you need to care about. You just need to care that Node.js is emitting an event and it's going to be Node.js.available. And so with that, I know that Node.js.available is going to be emitted at some point. And so I'm just going to react on that state. And when that state occurs, then I do my thing. I deploy Ghost. I set up Nginx. And then here is my reactor. Basically, when Nginx is available and Node.js is available, I run an install method, and I have a few lines that set templates and install. And you can see here where I make use of the wrapper, and I just install the dependencies for Ghost. And the second part of this, so this is one part, right? This is just, that's all it's doing. It's installing Ghost, making sure Node is installed, making sure Nginx is available. And the second part, which gets really interesting, is this interface part, right? Like I have MySQL available. When that comes available, when I do a juju deploy MySQL, juju add relation, MySQL to Ghost, okay, well, Nginx will be available. And now I have this other item that's going to be available. It's a database that's going to be available. And what that is telling me is that, okay, MySQL is available, it's installed, it's running, you can do whatever you want to with it. And so for me, I set up the connection between Ghost and MySQL. And what that does is it does whatever it does in the background, converts your Ghost blog to make use of MySQL, and that's it. That's all there is to it.
So I have a question, and you brought this up earlier where you said that the MySQL layer was defining kind of a conversation. So step me through what you needed to do in order to integrate with MySQL. Like, you make it sound like you just added an include and then you had an object that was available.
Yeah. So let's see if I can do this. I don't want to do it where it's too involved. So basically,
we'll just talk about how you got MySQL in there.
Okay, so you know, easily enough, I went to my web browser, and I went to the de facto site where the interfaces and the layers are available, and I looked here and I said, "Sweet, there's a MySQL interface." Okay, so I'm just going to go and look at MySQL, and there's some documentation, and right here it tells me that this interface is going to emit these states. It's going to emit a dot connected and dot available, and that relation name is going to be your database or whatever you decide to call it when you're building your charm. And so when I know from reading this doc that when it's available, I'm going to have access to these methods. And there's a nice little example here that shows me how to use it. And that's exactly how I used it. That's Ghost. That's exactly how I used it here. Of course, I have a DB here, you know, but you can see the actual methods that I make use of. So I know that when I relate, when I use this MySQL interface and it becomes available to me, I know that I'm going to have access to these methods, and these methods are going to tell me what I need to know to connect to MySQL to my application. Yeah, and that's it. That's all it is to it. You just include this layer, and then it's magic, to be honest. I mean, it's, I don't have to think about anything. I don't have to write a bunch of hooks in my charm, like a DB relation change or any of that nonsense. All I need to worry about is that my database is available and I can connect to it, and off we go.
So I see something else that's interesting to call out is I saw in your layer.yaml that you have a layer Nginx, but I see down here you have a website.available. How did that come to be?
Right. So, okay. So with that, you have Nginx, and this might not be the right way to do it, but this is what I came up with on how I developed
it. Open your metadata. There you go. Bam. So it requires database. Oh, wait. Yes. You don't even have it defined here, so it is an Nginx.
Yeah. Perfect. So this even is more,
even better.
Yeah. So this is how I did it. I wanted to, you know, isolate each layer as much as possible, right? So the way that this works with Nginx is so Nginx is going to inherit, is going to consume the HTTP interface. And because of that, it's going to provide that, this website, which connects to the HTTP interface, which I got from going to interfaces website and saw that, hey, cool, there's an HTTP interface. I'm going to make use of it. And it tells me when I create a provides or requires, website.available is going to be available to me, will be one of the states that I can react upon. And then I have access to a port, and I can configure whatever port, whatever I need that website to do. And so I'll get to that in just a second. But so going back to Nginx, I wanted to keep everything, you know, isolated as possible, right? So Nginx, just all it does is Nginx stuff, and it exposes Nginx things like the website interface. And so that's how I developed this layer. It might not be the right way, but this is how I kind of envisioned it looking. And you can see, like with the Node.js charm, it's got a few helper methods here. And then it's got a hook. And so I'm going to know that when I consume this layer, it's going to install Nginx, and it's going to tell me that Nginx is available. And then I know that I can do whatever I need to do to make use of Nginx.
That's awesome. So you now have a three-factor app that you can scale horizontally at every tier.
Yes. So in addition, so what the cool thing is that now that I have an Nginx layer, I'm going to consume it. I know it's going to give me my website interface. And so at this point, what do I need to do to make Ghost scalable? And the answer is not much. I mean, I know that I have an interface for HTTP, and it's going to give me, the Nginx is going to give me these states. So I know that, you know, when the website becomes available, when that state is emitted, I configure it. And what that allows me to do, without going into too much on the semantics behind the relations and stuff like that, it lets me do a Juju deploy HA proxy, relate those two, and now I can scale it as much as I want.
Excellent.
And I didn't have to write 1,000 lines of Python code to make it work. And it's all clean, it's all nice, and it's great.
It's reasonable and organized. That's excellent. Yes. Thank you for the overview, Adam.
Yeah.
So, to anybody else that's looking to get started, what would be your recommendations?
Recommendations, if you use IRC, join the #Juju channel. There is like 200 people sitting there. Ask your question, people respond. If you want to get involved with writing charms or writing charms in the reactive pattern, it's very easy. You just need a Launchpad account. If you want to start contributing and adding your own layers, just do that. Really the way I got into it was I have an application that I want to make use of in Juju land, and I started with my very base, like what do I need to make it work? Well, I need Node.js, I need Nginx, and I may want to scale it, so I need HAProxy. And so I have all those things. Now I need to build layers, and that's what I did. I said, I need nodes, I'm going to build a node layer. All it's going to do is node. Going to do an Nginx, all it's going to do is Nginx. And at that point, that's all it is. I have my layers, I know what it's supposed to do, I know how to consume it. And that's it, really. Yeah, I mean, Charms Reactive, you know, it's still new, right? It's still in its infancy. So, I mean, really, the only way I feel like you're going to get a good grasp on it easily is to just try writing an application or a charm application and just see if you can consume something and see what it does. And what's cool about it is you kind of understand at that point that you're going to be reacting to something. So if that reaction doesn't happen, then it gives you a good spot to look at. You know, it's very easy to debug, right? Like, you know that Nginx is supposed to be available. Well, my application didn't install, so that can mean that Nginx is not available. I don't see a traceback or any real error messages, so it makes it easy to dig in and find out where the problems are. And it really makes it easy to iterate on the charm development as well, because you're not going through, you know, hundreds of lines of Python code trying to figure out what's going on with charm helpers or whatever else.
It's excellent. All right. Well, that's all that I had time for today. So thank you, Adam Stokes.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, this is good stuff. I mean, it's what it needs to be, I think, to get people interested in developing charms.
I agree wholeheartedly. This is why we're calling it Charming 2.0.
I like it.
All right. And with that, we are out.